Northeast Tonight, brought to you by Oil India Limited, conquering newer horizons.
Welcome to Northeast Tonight, the show that decodes the region. The protests against the Citizenship Amendment Act has spread outside the Northeast, and now multiple cities have been hit by the agitation across the country. But the stark difference is that while the opponents of this legislation outside Northeast look at this act from a Hindu-Muslim prism, arguing that the CAA violates the secular principles in our constitution, here in the region, this act is seen as a threat to the language and culture of the Assamese and other indigenous communities. Now the question arises, is the agitation so very emotive in the Northeast because the CAA is seen as posing a threat to local language and way of life? Are the changes in the citizenship law opposed in the region because people here fear another stream of demographic invasion, this time by minority Hindus from Bangladesh after the Muslim influx? To discuss these and more, I am joined by Professor Nanigopal Mohanta, professor at Guwahati University. I also have Professor Rajiv Hendik, also from Guwahati University. Commentator Sunil Nath will be joining me soon. Former MP Kirib Chalia will also join the program. I also have leading political analyst Shyamkanta Mohanta and advocate Aman Wadud on the show. Gentlemen, welcome to the program. Dr. Nanigopal Mohanta, first question to you. Dr. Nanigopal Mohanta, you know, we have now seen the agitation spread outside the Northeast. The main argument of people outside the Northeast, they are looking at it from a Hindu-Muslim prism. You know, but in the Northeast, the agitation perhaps is much more widespread, much more inclusive among the protesters, because they're looking at it as a threat to their indigenous language and culture. Do you agree with this? Do you see a difference yourself?
Vasbir, there is no doubt about the fact that the expression of this anti-Kaab or Kaab movement in various parts of India, it has got various manifestations. As you have said, in other parts of the country, it's essentially a Hindu-Muslim issue, and in case of Assam, it's more about cultural and identity of the people of this region, particularly of the indigenous people. There is no doubt about the fact that there is an inclusiveness, and people from all walks of life have come out to give vent to their grievances that this kind of provision in the Kaab, that it would provide citizenship to those people, particularly Hindus and others, till 2014, 31st December, is a serious cause of concern for all sections of the society. There's no doubt about that. And because it is precisely because Assam has taken the burden of foreigners till 1971, 25th March.
Right.
Then again, in series of Citizenship Amendment Act, it's not that for the first time Assam or in India, we have found the influx or the acceptance of foreigners. Again, from 26 January 1950 till 1987, we have accepted the descendants of foreigners as the citizen of this country. Then the third wave of acceptance of foreigners is from 1st July 1987 till 3rd January 2004, whereby we have accepted only one of the parents should be the Indian citizen, the other could be illegal migrant, doesn't matter. So we have accepted, it is not worthy for the first time,
right,
Assam or Indian is accepting this kind of, now I'm coming to the point. But yes, there is a kind of inclusiveness, there is a kind of representativeness from all walks of life. But now, there are some elements, as has been coming out slowly and gradually, Perhaps many of the political parties have taken this as an alibi or as an instrument to pull to
okay,
fulfill
we'll, some Dr. of the Nanugopal political Mahanta, objectives we'll talk
which
about
I would
that.
Believe
we
would
will
come
out
to
that.
In the
we
days
will,
to come.
We will come to that, Dr. Rajiv Hendik. You know, basically the thrust of the question is, as you have seen today, there is fresh protests in New Delhi. Once again, there are stone peltings. The protesters are saying that, oh, this is absolutely a communal legislation. This is against Muslims and so on and so forth. Although our Prime Minister and top BJP leaders, government leaders are repeatedly saying that Indian Muslims have nothing to fear. But my question is not that. My question is, how different is the perception towards the Citizenship Amendment Act in the Northeastern region? What is the difference according to you and why?
I think not only in the Northeastern region, also in West Bengal. I think they are having a sort of same problem because their identity, Bengali identity, is also inclusive. They also talk of Qazi Nazrul Islam along with Rabindranath Tagore at the same rate as we do about many of our luminaries in our society, like Ajahn Pir and Shankar Dev. And you know, the list is endless, where you have people of both the religion who have contributed to the larger Assamese community here and the Bengali community there. So this should not be looked in the binaries of actually Hindus and Muslims. Now the problem, what the problem
do
is
you
actually
think, do you think
the othering of the Muslim actually the
okay.
point is
no, no, no,
what
no.
has happened
do you think,
is
do you think that since the Northeast, the agitation groups, whether it is the ASSO, whether it is the NESO, whether it is the individual civil society, do you think since they are not looking at it as a from a Hindu Muslim perspective, Hindu Muslim prism in the Northeast, do you think that is the reason why the agitation is so spontaneous and so
true.
Widespread in our, is that the reason?
Yeah, that is true. Actually, this is secularism is a way of life, actually. Our experience is like that. And in the Northeast, we all know that more than 250 tribes live here. So the amount of diversity that
okay.
is here. So
okay.
I mean to say, there is the DNA of Northeast is that we celebrate diversity.
Okay.
We celebrate diversity, we are inclusive,
okay.
and we don't look
right.
at it from the prism of binaries like Hindus and Muslims.
Okay, so it's not simple as that, it's not a Hindu-Muslim issue. Shyamkanu Mohanto, you know, tell me, I mean, the threat, the perceived threat to the indigenous languages, in the case of Assam, the threat to the Assamese language, do you think that is the trigger why people are coming out in such large numbers in protesting? As Dr. Nanugopal Mohanta said, some people are trying to take advantage. There's a third force. That will definitely be there. People will try to take advantage. That's a different issue. But what is the broad picture that emerging from this movement, according to you?
You asked the difference between what is happening outside India, what CPI is a communist fighting. They are saying that the Hindu-Muslim issues. If Muslim is included, they'll be happy. And here, it will burst. If Muslim is included as a part of this entire exercise, then a lot of liberals or a lot of these movements will be happy because their fight is, they are saying that Muslims are left out in the CAA. Here, if it is...
Here means in the Northeast.
In the Northeast, and specifically in Assam. If it happens, the whole movement will become 10 times bigger. So there lies the difference between Northeast
and India.
So
what is the prime difference according to you?
Rest of it. See, this is an identity. This is an identity. Here, Hindus and Muslims are coming together. The Assam specifically, I'll try to concentrate on Assam. Assam is a history of Shankar Devo and how we have the society has been formed from like this. And the identity issue. Assam is identity. The identity of language, identity of culture. Because the large-scale immigration, again, I want to tell you quite clearly, the scale of immigration, what Assam has seen, the rest of the country has not seen. The scale is a very huge scale of immigration.
Absolutely.
Which is making us absolutely insecure. The sense of insecurity is making, because already so many immigrants are here, so we are feeling insecure. That's why this spontaneous movement is
right.
not done by Congress, BJP. Yes, later on, what we have seen in Kolakshetra, this is a very serious assault on our culture too. So that is, these are the lumpen elements which are going to derail this movement. But as of now,
the police will find that out.
As of
Let's
now,
keep that aside.
As of now, this is a movement for identity
movement
of Assamese
people
and protection
of Assamese people. Assamese people protection. Now, you see, I have to make it clear before I ask this question to Mr. Sunil Nath and then to Advocate Aman Wadud. You see, the leaders of the All Assam Students Union, which is the protagonist of this anti-CAB CAA movement, they have been repeatedly saying that our agitation is not against Bengalis, our agitation is not against Hindus, our agitation is not against Muslims. Our agitation is simply against illegal migrants. So that is what has been made clear. With this backdrop, I'm asking you this question, Mr. Sunil Nath. Is it a fear of losing the Assamese? Is it a greater fear about a threat to the Assamese language today? See, the fear of the Assamese language does not mean the people are anti-Bengali. Let us be clear about that. So everyone has the right to protect their own language. Perhaps the hesitation is that. How do you look at it, or do you have a different view?
Well, if you allow me, I would like to put my perspective correctly. See, for me, Indian nationalism and Assamese nationalism have a symbiotic relationship in the sense that they grew up together and complemented each other. But then again, there's a basic difference. When you talk of Rashtriyatavad, Hindu Rashtriyatavad, then it is basically Hindu, Indian Rashtriyatavad. And in Assam, that is what Lakshminarayan Besparua and Jyoti Bharagola, Vishnu Rabha taught us is Assamese nationalism.
Yeah.
And Assamese nationalism is basically secular in the sense that Hindu, Muslim or inclusive. It is basically inclusive. Even Mahatma Gandhi and others, those who preached Indian nationalism, Hindu Indian Rashtriyatavad, that was secular. But now what Narendra Modi ji and Amit Shah ji is preaching and
yeah.
practicing is basically Hindu-based Indian nationalism. Mm-hmm. And we differ with that. We differ with that, I differ with that, and Assamese people differ with that. So
okay.
that is where our perspective
is different.
Less.
A perspective clash with the perspective in the mainland.
Yes.
So that is what you are saying. Now, Aman Wadud, being a lawyer, my question is, you know, there are 13 petitions in the Supreme Court. Everyone is challenging the Citizenship Amendment Act. Now, most of the petitions and most of the perception outside, when we talk to the lawyers and the legal fraternity, they're saying that, oh, this act violates the Constitution. How can you introduce religion as a criteria for granting citizenship? But you are a lawyer, at the same time you are a resident of Assam. My question is, how do you look at it? How do you link this two from a legal perspective as well as the nature of the agitation and the arguments put forward by leading organizations like ASU and others?
See, firstly, I think the lawyers or the anyone who is protesting against this act is right that, you know, this Citizenship Amendment Act is against the basic structure, against this constitution, against the secular nature of this country, which is there in the preamble of the constitution.
Yeah.
But, you know, the protest outside Assam is not because that Muslims are not included in this bill. The protest is because this Citizenship Amendment Bill cannot be seen in isolation. People are seeing it through the NRC, the nationwide NRC that the government want to implement it all over the country. Now, when you read the Citizenship Amendment Bill with the NRC, nationwide NRC, then when the NRC will be implemented, then all non-Muslims will be protected during the NRC process. Only the citizenship of Muslims will be doubted. That is the crux of this matter outside.
But the Northeast is not concerned much about that. Northeast is particularly concerned about protecting the language and the way of life.
That I completely agree. Here, of course, I mean, even the ASU have said that, you know, the bill is communal. But I think the important issue here is, you know, this act of violates Assam Accord, and if and it is all the movement, entire
okay.
movement is also because of the movement of the culture and the language.
Act violates the Assam Accord, Dr. Nonigopal Mohanto. I mean, from a legal point of view, the act violates the Assam Accord, but now the government may say, or the lawyers, some of the lawyers may say, a section of lawyers may say that Assam Accord does not have constitutional sanction. So somebody might like to, Assam Accord is not sacrosanct. So some of these kind of arguments are also coming up now. So how do you look at it? How does it stand legal scrutiny? Of course, you are not a lawyer, but how do you think the movement is going to pan out points and counterpoints in the days ahead?
I have 2-3 points to make here.
Yeah.
Well, you see, the most important clause of the Assam Accord being the 1971 25th March. That after
right.
that, nobody would be accepted as the legal citizen of this country. That is the most important part. The second important part, as I look at it, is the constitutional protection, legislative, you know, administrative or linguistic protection to the Assamese people. That is number two. Third part is the protection of land and, you know, the encroachment of land, because these are all related to the identity issue. Now, coming to the first issue, that is 21-25 March. Now, if you look at the rate of expulsion of foreigners, in fact, I can give statistics to say that it would take about 1,000 years to deport. As an Assamese, I want that those people should be there, already detected.
And deported.
There may be, you know, deletion should be there, and that should be deported.
Yes.
But practically, if you look at the average expulsion of foreigners from Assam is less than 80. If this is the rate of expulsion of 80, it would take about 1,000 years to drive them out. Who would accept them? Now the point is, if they can be expelled, I'll be the happiest person. In fact, that is what we want. But till that happens, my point is that, Wazbir, we should not, you know, try to come out of the proposal that is being given out, that is the constitutional protection to the Assamese people. I think there is a kind of a committee is coming up, promise given by this government. I think just because it is BJP who is coming up with this proposal, we should not give it up, because it's urgent necessary that we protect our land. It's urgent necessary that
Got
we
it.
Can protect
Got
at
the point.
Least
let me, let
90
me.
Constituencies of, out of 126 constituencies.
Right.
And I have to detail it out why this is so essential, because you look at the constituency today, I have those constituencies one after another. There's a serious demographic trade to the Assamese culture and identity. If we do not protect them, our identity, our culture will be in trade. That is why I believe at this point today we can debate about, and it is our desire that we want to drive them out.
Absolutely.
But constitutional protection is the need of the hour.
Constitutional protection is the need of the hour. Now, Rajiv Andik, you know, Dr. Nandagopal Mohanto said that constitutional safeguards is extremely important. He's obviously referring to the full implementation in lateral spirit of Clause 6. My question is, do you think that will be able to counter, that will be a good counter to the Citizenship Amendment Act? You know, in the Northeastern region, a lot of other tribal states like Manipur is now happy that, oh, inner line permit has been given. Now, today, Meghalaya cabinet has passed a resolution today, saying that, you know, they will pass a bill to move, to bring the state under the inner line regulations. Now, Manipur has got inner line. Now, Meghalaya is going to get inner line. There is a NESO demand that entire Northeastern region should come under inner line. Now, do you think inner line, and now, first question, of course, do you think Clause 6, as Dr. Nandagopal Mohanto said, and several others, including the Prime Minister and the Union Home Minister, are saying that Clause 6 will take care of all the concerns. Do you think it is as simple as that?
It's not so simple, actually. And the very defining the Assamese people itself has taken quite a lot
of
time.
No, don't worry. And that will be defined. Don't worry. Definition, no. Acceptable definition will definitely come.
Yeah, and that definition will have to be inclusive. And as has been, as has panned out, actually, perhaps it will include all the people who were here by 1951. So that is what has come out. The grapevine has it like that.
Let's talk. Yeah. What will the constitutional safeguard? There'll be safeguards in assembly and parliamentary seats, there'll be safeguard to the language and culture of the Assamese people. Do you think this is going to counter the effects of the CAA? Because CAA, people are fearing that there'll be, you know, demographic invasion. That is what people are looking at.
That is true. And I feel this should have come earlier than the CAA, then things would not have happened like that.
That is the point you are making.
Yeah.
The constitutional safeguard should have come before the CAA.
Before the CAA.
I'll come back to you.
And let me tell you, wherever ILP is, there are protests even there.
Even in the ILP state?
Yeah.
In Arunachal, there are protests. Shyamkanta Mohanto, how do you respond to this?
I just want to add up. I need two strategies. One is that this whole state needs to be... they're burning. It's a burning. You need to cancel it down. So first thing is that, what is possibility? ILP in terms of, is it possible to have ILP for Brahmaputra Valley? I have written about it in social media.
What do you think?
First thing is, if ILP is possible in Brahmaputra Valley, I'm for it. And Barak Valley doesn't want CAB, so it wants CAB, so there is no need. So if possible, first thing with Brahmaputra Valley can be covered in the ILP, then what happens? The car is gone for Brahmaputra Valley. A lot of Assamese people will be happy. That is first thing. If it is logistically possible, number one, let me ask, this is a very serious subject. My subject, which I've been talking about it for a long time. Second subject is about constitutional safeguard. This is possible. this is doable, and BJP did a big mistake by not introducing it first. What the committee, what they have done with you also as a member, some prominent personalities of Assam are discussing across the nook and breadth of Assam. That's a wonderful step. So what is important to deliver it? Consciousness safeguard, why people are cynical? People of Assam has been cynical. Government of India has made a lot of promises. Nothing has been delivered. Nothing has been delivered. If now, let me, I just want to ask Prafulla Mohanta, Tarun Gogoi, they have been talking about it for a long time.
Yeah.
Since 1985, what Prafulla Mohanta has done, what Tarun Gogoi has done, now they are fighting for against CA, what they have done for constitutional safeguard. Nothing. Now they have been done doing something
okay.
with a good intention. I believe we should give a benefit of doubt. But at the same time, we must we are cynical. We need results.
Nanigopal Mohanta, you wanted to make a point. Okay, Nanigopal, we have lost the signal to Dr. Nanigopal Mohanta. I'm coming to you. I'm also joined by former MP Kirib Chalia. Now, Aman Vadut, East Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation, that actually regulates the inner line permit system in the entire Northeast. If you look at the Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation, originally, it is also mentioned that districts of Kamrup, Naugaon, Sipsagar, and so on and so forth. So technically, and undivided Kachar district. So Manipur could have the inner line extended to Manipur just because it is already there in the Bengal Eastern Frontier Regulation. So Assam, it is not too difficult, isn't it? What do you think as a lawyer?
It's not practical, actually. If you see, there will be a lot of these prospective beneficiaries of Citizenship Amendment Act all over Assam. What will happen to those people? And there will be mass exodus to non-ILP areas. So I don't think ILP will be a practical solution. I think...
No, if the entire Assam is put under ILP, then what happens?
So if the entire Assam is put under ILP, then Citizenship Amendment Act will not be implemented here. So the problem will be whatever number we are hearing today, 5 lakhs or whatever it may be, there will be mass exodus of these peoples. And like everyone is saying, that these peoples are here for years or decades. I mean, so I don't think there is a practical, ILP is not a practical solution. Clause 6 definitely is a practical solution. I agree with sir that the definition of Assamese people should be there and it should be inclusive. You need to understand, you know, when I hear that there is a wave of influx, Muslim influx, we need to understand that 1951, the Muslim population of Assam was 24.7%. Many of them are today abused and accused of being Bangladeshi Muslims. So we will have to understand that anyone who, if at all 1951 is the cutoff date for defining indigenous people or Assamese people. So the under the clause 6 of the Assam Accord, the constitutional protection should be there, and the definition of indigenous people or Assamese people should be very inclusive.
Okay, inclusivity is the key. That is what Aman is saying. Let me go to Mr. Kirib Chalia. Mr. Kirib Chalia, you know, the question is, we are basically discussing why the CAA outside Northeast is viewed from a Hindu-Muslim prism, while in the Northeastern region, it is looked as more of a threat to the culture and identity of the indigenous people. Now, do you have a different view? Why is the agitation in the Northeast so inclusive? Why is the agitation so spontaneous? How do you view it?
See, I think this is, I have said it earlier also. The psyche of the Northeast people, the psyche of the so-called mainland has always been at odds. That's why Delhi could not, we speak about Delhi not understanding the Northeast. Many of our youths, I have one sitting beside me, they went to arms. Certain numbers are still there, not only in Assam, but also in places like Nagaland.
Yeah.
They hardly understood what the Northeast was. Don't forget, Northeast was the central point of assimilation of Aryan and Mongoloid people. Some two great civilizations. Whereas, and because of that, the fact is that Hinduism here underwent a lot of changes and it became an extremely liberal Hinduism. You'll be shocked to know when I was sitting at Kanchiram and I was telling him that, look, in our places, in our Namghars, it is a middle class person who is to distribute the prasad. He was shocked. I said, is it possible? Kisne bataya nahi? I said, unfortunate. We don't have that kind of rigid castic division. We never had that.
Therefore, it is inclusive.
That's why. That is why this concept of inclusive assimilation and this concept of, you know, we even have a matriarchal, Hindu society, which is matriarchal. for the normal Indians, that is mainland Indians, this is totally alien. So, it's an alien philosophy. They live in terms of
it comes from
hatred.
Here. That is, that is the threat.
Let me finish.
That is the threat.
No, let me tell you. They live in terms of extreme hatred towards Hindus and Muslims. They live amidst extreme caste divisions. They live in huge human exploitation with dowries and all. We are so above them.
No, what is the point you are trying to make?
The point I'm trying to make, they are not capable of understanding our psyche and our style, our type of life.
So,
I just one line to it.
Yes.
The civilizational difference. Assamese people have shown their secular character here. A lot of people, have, especially in the Maya poetry, and a lot of, you know, there's an attempt to make Assamese people xenophobic. This is an answer. The people, spontaneous protest coming out, Hindus, Muslims coming together as an answer to a lot of people who have tried to portray Assamese as xenophobic and a lot of negativity. This is a typical character built up by Sankardeva, and over the years, this is the culture of Assamese people. I'm very proud
rooted.
We have done. What I think Assam forest change is showing direction to the entire country, how a society should live. So now there are issues of identity issue, which needs to be handled, which said to be handled, a lot of sensitivity, keeping the national interest in mind.
So, I'll quickly go for a break. I'll be back in less than a minute. Viewers, don't go away. I'll be right back. Welcome back. Mr. Sunil Nath, you know, how do you look at this whole thing? I'm coming to you, Dr. Nanigopal Mohanta, right after Mr. Sunil Nath. Mr. Sunil Nath, basically, as we are saying that we believe in the syncretic tradition. Now, that is beside the point. We are not discussing intellectual stuff here. So, but basically, this, if you look at the current agitation, if you look at the current opposition to the Citizenship Amendment Bill, do you think we have the BJP as the mover of this bill, and the BJP is in power in most of the areas, most of the states in the northeastern region? How difficult is the situation, is it going to be for the BJP to convince their central leadership that we need to relook, although it has been passed by parliament? Do you think it is possible? I'm coming with this question to all my panelists.
If you are asking about the BJP leaders in Assam...
No, I'm not asking about the BJP leaders. I'm asking about the BJP government in Assam.
BJP government in Assam, yes. Anyway, the same thing. They won't be able to convince their leaders because they were the ones who told their leadership that it is okay to implement CAB or CA, however you would like to address it, in Assam. Because they said, we have been able to convince our people that, okay, we are Hindus first and Assam is next. But for us...
That is where they have made a mistake, according to you.
I think they made a terrible mistake in the sense that Assamese people, yes, of course, Hindus, they are Hindus, Muslims, they are Muslims.
But how do you know that they are saying that? They have never said that in public. The Assam BJP leaders have not said that in public. We cannot attribute that. We are just assuming, Mr. Sunil Nath.
Well, when the northeastern states talk to Home Minister, all the other states put up their own proposal and got their own defenses. But our leaders in Assam, they remain silent.
Okay, why are our leaders silent? Dr. Nanigopal Mohanta, the question is, now you see, the BJP-led NDA is the mover and shaker of this Citizenship Amendment Bill. If we are discussing the Northeast, now most of the state government, majority of the state governments in the Northeast are with the BJP. Assam included. Now, how difficult it is going to be for the ruling party leaders from here, why is it so difficult for them to convince the central government that something needs to be done? What is your assessment?
I would say definitely, I would agree with Sunil Nath that our perhaps leadership has failed rather to convince the central leadership about the fallout of the CAB or CAP, whatever you call it. So, still, I think there's still this time that we can include perhaps certain amendments or maybe, you know, to rethink about the whole situation of CA or Citizenship Amendment Act. So that I would say it's a failure on the part of the BJP to, they have failed to understand the pulse of the people. That is a major serious drawback on the part of the leadership. But having said that, what I wanted to respond, there are many historical mistakes that we have made during the time of Assam agitation.
Right.
There are examples galore that, we have not done many, we haven't corrected many historical wrongs. Today we say that constitutional protection, the definition of Assamese, would be problematic. Who created this problem? If you look at the clause 6, the way it was defined in such a manner of ambiguity, there was no definition at all. And it said proper arrangement would be made. Why had we not made some specific arrangement in clause 6? That is number one. But today, defining Assamese is not a monumental task or a Himalayan task that we can, we are not be in a position to define it. There are layers of definition, a committee is there in which you are also a member. The question is not about that. I'm all for the, eradication, or I vouch for the scrapping of this act. But at the same time, my point is this, that if we can have the constitutional protection, let us ensure at least 1896. There's a concept
very
of
well
Bumiputra
said.
In Malaysia.
Yes.
In Malaysia. And why can't we? Because why can't we have this here in Assam? We need this constitutional protection precisely because we have taken these foreigners till 71. Again, the Congress government has made modification, Citizenship Amendment Act 26 January 1950, till 1987 we have accepted. Till 2004
now,
we have accepted foreigners.
Okay,
and that is why Assam needs constitutional protection.
Okay.
We need the protection of
constitutional
land.
Constitutional protection,
so
that is what Dr. Nalin Kumar Mohanto is repeatedly...
If there is political will, if we can pass the CAP, we can also pass this indigeneity protection for Assamese people.
Absolutely, I think very well said, Dr. Nalin Kumar Mohanto. If the government can pass the Citizenship Amendment Act, they can also pass a law or bring about amendments that protects the indigeneity, protects the Assamese people, and provides them with... I have a breaking news coming in, but before that, Rajiv Hendik, do you think the government still has options? Government still can, because the because the Union Home Minister has told Meghalaya Chief Minister Conrad Sangma that yes, after Christmas, we'll sit down and resolve your concerns over the Citizenship Amendment Act. Do you see, what do you read out of this? What do you make of this?
A lot of things will depend on what this committee that is looking into the clause 6 of the Assam Accord, what they submit. I think they have been given a time frame. I think you will be knowing to submit it as soon as possible. And on the basis of that, what legislations are made, that will make it clear whether the identity of the people will be protected or not. But the present problem of CAA actually goes beyond that.
Okay.
It is beyond that. And a lot will depend on what happens tomorrow at the Honorable Supreme Court of India.
All right. I'll be coming straight to Shyamakanta Mohanto, but I have breaking news coming in. You see, Assam Finance and Health Minister Himanta Biswa Sarma has made some sensational revelations in connection with the violence during the Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act protest in Guwahati on December 11th and 12th. Talking specifically to the media on the mob activity outside Janata Bhavan, Sharma said role of a senior youth Congress leader has been found to be instigating the crowd and leading them towards the state secretariat, that is the Janata Bhavan. Himanta Biswa Sarma revealed that the role of an intellectual as well in guiding the crowd towards Janata Bhavan. Let's listen into what Himanta Biswa Sarma actually said.
এখেতৰ নাম কামৰুণ হক চৌধুৰী কামৰুণ ইছলাম আৰু এখেত অসম প্ৰদেশ যুৱ কংগ্ৰেছৰ সভাপতি যোৱাকালি মই কৈছিলোঁ যে NSY ভাইচ প্ৰেচিডেণ্ট গৰাকী লিপ্ত আছিল শংকৰদেৱ কলাক্ষেত্ৰত জ্বলোৱা ছেক্ৰেটেৰিয়েটত জুই জ্বলোৱাৰ লগত যিটো মই কৈছিলোঁ যে ফেচবুকক কংগ্ৰেছৰ মানুহখিনিয়ে ফেচবুকত পোষ্ট দি মাতি আনিছিলে এওঁ জুই জ্বলাই আঁতৰি আহিছিলে সদ অসম ছাত্ৰ সন্থাকে হওক গণতান্ত্ৰিক আন্দোলনটোক বেয়া কলংক দিয়াকে হওক বা চৰকাৰক ক্ষতি কৰাটোকে হওক লাহে লাহে এই ঘটনাৰ লগত আমি বহুতখিনি ফটো আৰু ভিডিঅ'গ্ৰাফ আমি পাইছোঁ য'ত PFI পপুলাৰ ফ্ৰণ্ট অৱ ইণ্ডিয়া আৰু কেম্পাছ ফ্ৰণ্ট অৱ ইণ্ডিয়া যিটো ষ্টুডেণ্ট ইছলামিক মুভমেণ্টৰ যিটো ফ্ৰণ্টেল অৰ্গেনাইজেশ্যন তেওঁলোকৰো ভিডিঅ' বহুতখিনি আমাৰ যোগাৰ চলি আছে আর মই ভাবো নেক্সট টু থ্রি ডেজত পি এফ আইর মানুষের নামে এড্রেসের সত্যিও উইল বি এবল টু ডিসক্লোজ ইউ। ইলেকট্রনিক এভিডেন্স ইয়াত আহিছে যে এজন বুদ্ধিজীবীয়ে সিদিনাখন টেলিফোনত ইনস্ট্রাকশন দিছিলে যে জনতা ভবনের ভিতর সুমাই জনতা ভবনত জুই জ্বলাই দিব লাগে। কিন্তু বুদ্ধিজীবী মানে মই টিভিত দেখি থকা বুদ্ধিজীবীর কথাখিনি কোৱা নাই, সাইলেন্ট অপারেটর। ইয়াতে কন্ট্রোল করে আসে জনতা ভবনের এটেকটো ফ্রম টেলিফোন, দে ওয়ের কন্ট্রোলিং একটা কন্ট্রোল রুমের পর জনতা ভবনের এটেকটো কন্ট্রোল করে থাকা হয়েছিল আর কোয়া হয়েছিল যে ভাল হয়েছে লিডারবিল এটা ইয়ারপর আঁতরি যাওক, নাও ইউ শুড গো অ্যান্ড এটেক জনতা ভবন। নেদেখা বুদ্ধিজীবী এজন হু ইজ ওয়ার্কিং উইথ এ সেন্ট্রেল গভর্নমেন্ট অর্গেনাইজেশন অর ইনস্টিটিউট অর একাডেমিক ইনস্টিটিউট অর তেজপুর ইউনিভার্সিটি, আই আই টি, এইমস, এনেকুৱা ধরনের যে সেন্ট্রেল গভর্নমেন্ট ইনস্টিটিউশনত কাম করা, মই কিন্তু নামও লওয়া নাই যে তেজপুর আই আই টি, মই উদাহরণের কারণে দিছো, বাট আই এম নট পিন পয়েন্টিং টুয়ার্ডস তেজপুর হোক আই আই টি হোক, মই জানতে আপনার বুঝাবর কারণেহে কৈছো যে ওয়ার্কিং ইন এ সেন্ট্রেল গভর্নমেন্ট অর্গেনাইজেশন হি ওয়াজ মনিটরিং দ্য এন্টায়ার এক্সারসাইজ, যে এতিয়া ভাল হল, বিপ্লব আহি গল, লিডারখানি আঁতরি যা, মানুষখানি সুমাই যা। কাজী তনভি তঞ্জুম, কাজী তনভি তজনুম, সি ইজ এ নোন কংগ্রেস এক্টিভিস্ট ফ্রম নগাঁও। কাজী তনভি তঞ্জুম, সি ইজ এ নোন কংগ্রেস এক্টিভিস্ট ফ্রম নগাঁও। তেখেতে সকলকে 9:30 আসাম সেক্রেটারিয়েট আহিবৰ কাৰণে আৰম্ভ কৰিছিলে। এইটো হল তেওঁর পোস্ট, মো ফেসবুক টেসবুক ভাল করে চাব নোৱাৰা নাই, এই ডেটটো চাই দিও বাবা। তেওঁ লিখিলে এনেকে, অহাকালি সবকে মই রিকুয়েস্ট করছো।
অলরাইট, দেয়ার, দ্যাট ইজ দ্য আসাম ফাইন্যান্স মিনিস্টার, সিনিয়র বিজেপি লিডার, টকিং অ্যাবাউট ইউথ কংগ্রেস লিডার বিং সামহাও ইনভলভ, দ্যাট ইজ হোয়াট দ্য পুলিশ ইনভেস্টিগেশনস হ্যাভ রিভিলড, অবভিয়াসলি দ্যাটস হোয়াট ইজ টকিং অ্যাবাউট দ্যাট। ইনফ্যাক্ট another sensational point, another important point which Himanta Biswa Sarma has revealed during the press conference, he said during the press conference, he announced the formation of a special investigation team to probe the violence under DIG Mridulananda Sharma. The BJP top gun said that the Assam government will seek the services of a senior CBI or NIA officer for 6 months to monitor the SIT probe. He also revealed that of the 107 arrested in Guwahati, 48 are from outside the city. So let's listen into what Himanta Biswa Sarma talked about the formation of the special investigation team with the support from the NIA and the CBI.
আপোনালোকক আমি জনাইছিলোঁ যে অসম চৰকাৰে এই গোটেই কেছখিনি তদন্ত কৰাৰ কাৰণে আমি এছ আই টি এটা গঠন কৰিম আৰু থ্ৰ এছ আই টি আমি ইয়াতে ইনভেষ্টিগেশ্যন কৰিম। আজি আমাৰ অসম পুলিচৰ ডি আই জি আই পি এছ মৃদুলানন্দ শৰ্মাৰ নেতৃত্বত আমি এখন স্পেচিয়েল ইনভেষ্টিগেশ্যন টীম এটা গঠন কৰিছোঁ আৰু এই এছ আই টিত আছে মৃদুলানন্দ শৰ্মা, আই পি
এছ। All right, the Assam government, this is the breaking news coming in, the Assam government has decided to set up a special investigation team to look into, to probe the violence in the city on December 11th and 12th, and this SIT will be assisted by an officer from the NIA or the CBI for a span of 6 months so that the investigations, or for that matter, the probe is on track. So the Assam government really means business to find out the culprits involved in the mayhem that was created in the city over 2 days during the anti-CAA protest. Coming back to the discussions now, you see, Shyamkanta Mohanto, what is the road ahead for the Assam government, for that matter, particularly the central government, which moved and shaked, come up with the CAA? Do you think one has to take the Union Home Minister's comment made to Meghalaya Chief Minister Conrad Sangma, do you think seriously? And of course, the Assam Chief Minister Sarbananda Sonowal is also going to lead a delegation of the BJP and his allies to meet the Prime Minister and the Home Minister. And the AGP also has announced that it will make a demand to keep Assam outside the purview of CAB. So how do you look ahead, in the days ahead, what could the government do?
Yesterday, Dr. Himanta Biswa Sarma, during press conference, has said that the central government might invite the hesitating organizations.
Yes.
The table. That was the coup. With that coup, I'm quite certain there'll be a discussion between Government of India and ASU and ASU-led organization. So that discussion is happening. So it's very important that instead of emotion, we place a very tactical battle. The tactic to fight a battle for the people and the community, it has to be very tactical. So I believe my request to ASU and the organization is that first, can you remove car? That is first option. We'll be very happy if it is removed and black. But the second option, as I have said, I wrote in Facebook and it has become a discussion point. In fact, SDP has said the same point, if Brahmaputra Valley can be kept out of CAA. That is an option which I am seeing a possibility for discussion, number one. Number two, the bigger issue, bigger perspective, ASU and the organization must ask for a timeline for this, the Clause 6 implementation mechanism timeline in terms of what we want and what time it will be delivered. The cynicism that is crept in the people of Assam only can be tackled by this kind of measures.
Let me take a legal point of view. Aman Wadud, how easy or difficult it is for authorities to tweak, bring about changes in something that has just become law? Or is it not difficult at all?
No, the government will have to bring an amendment again. I think the best thing would be if the government want to do away with it, they give an affidavit before the Supreme Court. It will be easier for the Supreme Court to set it aside. So that's what
I think. Set it aside. Yeah. But what if the government wants to modify, bring about some changes and not set it aside completely? Is it possible?
See, one thing that what sir have said, that you know, bring ILP, bring Brahmaputra Valley under ILP, but that I don't think will be practical because a lot of people will have to move out from here. I don't think government is going to do that.
But for the sake of the greater interest of Assam, for the BJP's political interest also,
could do.
They might do. They should do it, and we want this. We want a solution to be. Otherwise, Clause 6 unlimited. This Andolan also carry unlimited. Government of India cannot afford this. Assam cannot boil. It's an active policy. There are a lot of political elections are coming in. I believe this is a time for bargain.
Okay.
This is a bargain on behalf of people of Assam.
Right. Now, Kirip Chalia, before this, Shyamkanta Mohanta was talking about what the days ahead, Chief Minister leading a delegation of all party, AGP on its own. My question is, can we take the AGP seriously? They voted in favor of the Citizenship Amendment Bill in Parliament, and very next day they decided to challenge it in court and lead a delegation to meet the Prime Minister and the Home Minister, saying that Assam should be left out of the purview of the Citizenship Amendment Act. So does anybody take the AGP seriously at all?
So many experts' comments are on. I would not like to...
I want to hear one more expert comment from you.
I would not like to join the chorus.
Give us a non-expert comment.
Just make a small submission before you.
Yeah.
You see, a patient has already been, he's a very serious cancer patient. He has not been diagnosed properly till now. And we are making so many, you know, giving so many medicines, including lollipops.
No, come. Don't beat around the bush.
I'm being very serious. Watch me.
Yeah, please make the point.
Five youths have died.
And yes.
The problem is people are still agitating on the streets on the camp. It's a very small matter. Make one small, you don't need big opinions, legal opinions for that. You make an amendment, make an announcement that Assam will be kept out of the purview of camp. Do that first, then talk about other things. Why are you talking about sending red headings? Why are you trying to distract things by talking about constitutional protection, this and that? This is a deliberate attempt by BJP to implement its faulty philosophy. After that, you talk about other things.
Sunil Nath, very straight point made by Kirip Chalia that don't beat around the bush, remove or keep Assam outside the purview of the Citizenship Amendment Act, things will be hunky-dory and normal. Do you think that is the right approach? Sunil Nath.
Very humbly, I would like to make my point that what I understand as a layman is citizenship of India is common and equal to all citizens of India. You can debar somebody from owning land in some areas, but once you are a citizen of India, you are free to roam around India. No state or no particular area, Sikh, Sindhi, whatever, can debar any citizen of India from entering that area. And like tribal belts in Assam, those who were there owning land while tribal belts were implemented, they still own land and they are owners of their own land. So those people who are in Assam, Brahmaputra Valley, and they get citizenship because of Ka, they would be entitled to own their own land as they did before. So I don't understand how can you debar a citizen of India from entering any ILP area or so-called six rule area, so-called
whatever. No, you cannot debar, but you can enter understand. With restrictions. Rajiv Hendik, your
sorry,
final comments.
I'm sorry, advocate but enlightened me on that.
Rajiv Hendik.
If you want something as a final comment, I would like to say that Assam is actually the conscience of India now. It has aroused the conscience of India, and the people of India should try to understand, should try to actually replicate, and should try to actually, if possible, make a way of life like the people of Assam, as they have done by celebrating diversity, by living together for many, many years, where these divides of religion, belief system does not exist. We are actually one, and that is the message actually Assam is sending out. And I think this is the time we all say that the rest of India don't understand us. This is the time they,
right.
should, they should try to understand.
Okay.
They may take it as a rallying point actually why it happened. And let me tell you one thing, that you know the US, they had, you know, the frontier culture. It developed into the American culture, which is so very liberal.
Okay.
And this liberalism can also go out from our frontier. They can,
all right.
If they adopt that, I think that will be the real secular India, perhaps, which even Mahatma Gandhi and other,
okay.
you know, freedom
now,
fighters
now,
dreamt
now,
of.
How, Dr. Nanigopal Mohanto, one, step two, step three, what are your recommendations to resolve this issue to the satisfaction of all? You know, the government also cannot, you know, do away with something which they've been doing so passionately. But what is the solution? The government has to listen to the masses, mass opinion. At the end of the day, the janta is the king.
Well, Wasbir, in the Citizenship Act, there should be a sub-clause in the clause 3. You know, in the 3 clause, in sub 4, sub-clause 4, this protection is given to the tribal areas of Assam, Meghalaya, Mizoram and Tripura because they are included in 6th schedule. So there should be another sub-clause for Assam. You know, what we are talking about, these concerns should be brought about in this Act. So in the sub-clause 5, by saying that nothing in the Act otherwise shall impact the Assam Accord, or it will not violate the Assam Accord, and in the original Act, we included 6A. That's why Assam needs this kind of protection in this Ka, number one. Number two, I would not agree with my respected elder Kirib Saliha. It was Congress, you know, tomorrow a different government will come. They will again stress it. That is why I'm telling you, Wasbir, so that it is a partisan decision. Look how the Citizenship Act and laws have been amended again and again and again. This 21-25th March has become 2004. Now it has been extended up to 2014. And NRC, we thought this will be the protection, you know, mechanism for Assamese people. How many foreigners would you practically get? So these political parties would play their own game plan. Tomorrow another political party would say come, and they will say,
yeah.
no.
I'm running short of time.
Other groups in this manner.
Yes.
So my point is that there are two-pronged strategy. Number one, fight with Ka. Secondly, also try to extract constitutional protection for the state. And this is the need of the hour. Otherwise, our land, our constituency will be ever, it will be taken
okay,
over.
I'm running
That's
totally out of time. Out of time. I'm going to want to fight Ka, at the same time extract constitutional safeguards.
My request to my organization. So it's basically, we'd have to fight with a lot of strategies. Strategy is to keep Assam out, first thing. If we keep Assam out from Ka, there will be victory for us. If not, can you get Brahmaputra Valley? Second, third is the six communities. The ST of the six communities. That will give a lot of confidence. Right now, and the third thing, constitutional safeguard has to be implemented, and it's very much possible, and we all must work towards achieving this. No politics, no Congress, no BJP. We want this to happen, and for that, we'll keep on fighting.
Don't politicize the issue. Fight against Ka, but extract as much as possible the constitutional safeguards. Is it doable? Long legal battle on the cards, Aman? Long legal, is it your prediction? Long legal battle ahead?
Well, 15 petitions have already been filed before the Supreme Court.
Okay.
So I think it's a long battle, if at all the court has to decide.
Long legal battle ahead. This is what we have come to know now. There are agitations. There is no end in sight. A series of agitations announced by Dasu. There is a battle being fought in the courts. And from the political level, the state BJP and the leaders in the northeastern region are gearing up to meet the central leaders once again to make them see reason and see what can be done, whether they can amend the act, tweak the act, remove it completely. Well, we'll have to wait and watch. On that note, I end this edition of Northeast Tonight. Thank all my panelists for engaging in this very, very heated discussion. Good night and goodbye.
Northeast Tonight, brought to you by Oil India Limited, conquering newer horizons.